Wednesday begins the embarking. Today begins the embarking of my 8-hour adventure walking around New York City just to prepare myself to be a dog walker, or if I don't get the position, just as a trial run or a personal experience for me. So far I woke up at about 7:30 in the morning, which is like about 50 minutes or an hour ago actually. I've taken a shower. This is what I'm going to be wearing for the walk, just a polo shirt and jeans. Yeah, I cooked some breakfast. It's not my usual affair. It's just steamed veggies, as you can see, coffee, and corn stew meal. So cooked some breakfast, and I also cooked a spread for what I'm going to be using on my veggie burritos for lunch. That's what I'm going to pack for lunch. Normally, I would pack something lighter, like hummus sandwich or peanut butter jelly sandwich, but turns out I don't have hummus in my fridge, so I just had to kind of make do. So this is pretty much my lunch. I prepared like a spread of beans, mushroom, onion, and pepper, put barbecue sauce over it. And I toasted some tortillas, and what I'm going to do is just put the spread on the thing. So, should make for a good lunch, really. Just two burritos. Like I said, on a work day, I would make it a lighter meal, like a hummus sandwich or something. But turns out I don't have that, so I actually have to go a little bit out of my way to make a more filling lunch, I guess. So I guess today, because of how special it is, I guess I'm treating myself to a good lunch. I feel now I'm ready to go outside. These are some of the things I'll be packing into my backpack that I'll be carrying. I put the binder here not because I need it, but because it provides support to my bag so that when I wear my backpack, almost with nothing inside, it doesn't feel like flimsy. Here's the burrito that I packed. So I can put it in there. I'm definitely going to be thirsty, so I have iced tea that I have left over from yesterday. I also have a bottle of water in there, but that was hard, because the pouch is smaller than the bottle itself. It was hard getting it out, so I don't want to get it out and get it in again just to show you guys. A little, orange fruit. That's the only fruit I had in the fridge. I normally carry more, and toilet paper, just because you never know. And also, I think I've started to develop spring allergies. I've never had allergies before, but I'm sneezing and my nose is running a lot, so that could be an issue. So I'm definitely packing toilet paper with me. So it does look really great outside. It looks really nice weather. And yes, that is the picture of me and my parents on my window. And so let's get ready to leave out. The coolest part about my apartment, I think, is that the walls are brick walls. I mean, that has its issues too, because apparently the brick wall in our living room had mold growing in it. But here we go, leaving our room. And by the way, do you like the fact that my wall is decorated from letters I got from people in the past? And, of course, sticky notes. So going out. And also my door as well is decorated with quotes, poster cards that I received from people. Picture of lightning on the city of Dubai. I always thought that was interesting. And stuff like that. All right, so let's go out. This is the living room. We're ready to head out for this amazing adventure, I guess. I think I'm going to wear my black shoes because they're more comfortable for me. All right. Let's go and see what the day is like today. I think I actually forgot my keys. Crap. Can't forget my keys. All right, so going out. We're on the second floor, so there's only one flight of stairs to worry about. Here we go. And this really gives me a chance to show off my neighborhood. It's a really nice neighborhood. I quite like it. I'm in Ridgewood, Bushwick. And right across from my apartment is a park. And I've only been to the park like once or twice. But it is a pretty cool park. They got a basketball court, and there's a high school all the way out there. See, this is actually a high school that you're seeing. So because of the high school, there's a lot of high schools. Kids that come by this park, there's a swing set, everything. So that begins my walk. This is the area that I live in. A lot of short two-story brownstones and a lot of corner stores and such. Should be an interesting day. I'm going to be walking for pretty much 8 hours straight. And as I do so, I'll be listening to a bunch of different podcasts that I need to catch up on. In my iPhone alone, I must have like, I don't know, 20 hours worth of podcasts. Throughout the whole day, I'm really just gonna walk at a really brisk pace. I think about this pace is good. Brisk pace, listen to, enlighten myself with a bunch of different podcasts and tweet along the way and see how the day goes. So far, day looks like it's going to be awesome. I walked out of the place a little bit too late, I suppose. It's about 9 a.m. in the morning. So I'm not going to be done with the day until like 5 p.m. Whoa, check out the art wall there. Pretty cool stuff. That's what I love about this, like being around Brooklyn. You know, there's so much community here that is just begging to be seen. Anyway, so much community and culture. Anyway, so I'm walking backwards just to kind of tread my path that I usually take when I'm going to Manhattan or going to tutor. Usually a lot of my students that I tutored were toward Brooklyn area. I mean, toward Manhattan area, not upwards towards Brooklyn. I only had two students that were living upwards, like farther up in Brooklyn than me. Now, doing this experience actually puts my neighborhood in a new light to me. You know, I always enjoyed here, but definitely being able to show this off to the rest of the world has set some meaning too. But I'm going down this path also because I want to show a building, a store that I encountered during as a tutor. It's an educational building. It sells educational products for educators. And it's a really great place. It helped me out a lot when I first started as a tutor. You know, one of my biggest challenges as a tutor was tutoring this kindergartner, which I did make a YouTube video about way back, like a month ago. But I had no materials to teach anything with, and I just went there and had a good conversation with the store manager there. And she provided with me a lot of stuff, and I got 10% discount for being a tutor, even though I can prove that I was a tutor or whatever, because I don't have like a tutor business card. But it's a really cool place. There's, of course, the stuff there is really really expensive, but I guess that's because it's local. It's not a chain store, so they can't mass produce and, you know, get stuff like at bulk for cheap prices. So the prices make sense, but it is a place that I love supporting. I wish I had a more bigger source of income too, and I wish I could just, you know, tutor kids for free, so that, I mean, I do tutor kids for free pretty much because I tutor for a nonprofit organization, but the company actually pays me $15 an hour. So that's the thing. So here's a corner store. Right next to corner store is the educational store. It's the Learning Curve. See that right there? It's closed right now. But it's a quaint little store with educational supplies. It's a great store, I think. It has a lot of neat products, a lot of kid products. I bought a whiteboard there that is portable, and it contains like a placeholder for markers and eraser board. It's really neat. And beneath the whiteboard, you can take the whiteboard out. It's a clear plastic thing, and you can switch it to different things. Like there's ones that are designed for. There's one that are designed for like kindergartners who are learning alphabets. So there's like a line and a squiggly line in the middle so they can practice their writing and stuff like that. This is the Food Bazaar. It's a humongous grocery store. It has pretty much everything that you could ever want from a grocery store. Don't really recommend going there all too often, but if I guess for those situations where you're just like, oh, I want to go to one place and just shop, you know, for everything, that's the place to go. I also like this. I also went to this store a lot, 99 cent store right there. I bought an umbrella there for $2.30. This is a ridiculous price. Like, I don't really, I guess, I'm guessing it's that cheap because it's probably, like, from exploded, like, No, it's probably made from China, and workers were probably paid like a penny per a day or something like that. I don't know, but the umbrella was super cheap. It was a rainy day. I think I had a job interview that day, so I had to quickly get it because I usually don't mind rain, but me being in a suit and tie and not being wanting to wet, so I got it. And that umbrella has lasted me to this day. Actually, last 2 weeks ago, I went to my friend's birthday party. I usually sling my umbrella, the tail of the umbrella, I usually hook it to my jean pocket or my coat pocket or whatever, so I don't really have to carry it or whatever. But apparently I dropped it somewhere, and I didn't realize that I lost it until like later when we were at a club or something. I was like, oh shoot, where's my $2.30 umbrella? So like I figured it's lost, but on our walk back home, I found it on the street, and I picked it up and was like, wow, this is destiny. This umbrella and me, we're destined to be together. So that's the umbrella story. It's a pretty, I don't know, it's a flimsy umbrella. I mean, it's a cheap umbrella. Like, if the wind blows a little too hard, it just flips over. But that's something I've encountered with all umbrellas, actually. I haven't actually ever owned a good umbrella. This is the train station, Myrtle Wyckoff Station here. It's pretty nice, I guess. It's, I think, pretty much the biggest station in like this part of Brooklyn, and it's like the only station I could count on. The M goes above ground, which is nice, but the M is very slow to come, and the L goes below ground. L train is one of the most efficient trains ever, but this weekend, yesterday and today, L trains aren't running, so this bus is actually gonna substitute the L train line. And when buses substitute train lines, that's just horrible. But that's Ridgewood Bushwick Senior Citizens Council. That's actually a huge company. That's just one of their departments, Benefits Enrollment Center. And I see these scattered throughout this part of this part of Brooklyn. I wanted to point that building out this company out in particular because I actually applied and interviewed for a job there before. Not these buildings. I think I have to walk like 20 more blocks or so to get to the place that I interviewed for. That one's a homeowner and foreclosure prevention services. So it's a really, they provide services for all kinds of anti-poverty efforts. I guess that doesn't sound that wrong. But yeah, definitely I applied to be a, what was it, site coordinator? No. What did I probably, it's such a long time. I kind of forgot what it was. I think it was kind of managing one of their, or not managing, but just kind of being an outreach worker and just being a referral guide for homeless people that comes to their shelters there. So it sounded like an amazing position, but you know, they really shouldn't have booked me for an interview because I was totally underqualified. I really didn't have any kind of experience that I can demonstrate under the belt, that I can prove that I can do this thing. I mean, I'm always willing to learn. I'm pretty sure that if they put me to it, I could have done the job. I think so. I mean, I'm confident. Who knows? Maybe if I got the job, I could have turned out to be a royal screw-up. Yeah, that was when I had really high hopes for, like, getting into the nonprofit world. Now I'm walking into the world of dog walking. Which is definitely not nonprofit, but what I'm hoping to do, if I get this position, is to make money by being a dog walker, afford living in Brooklyn or New York City, or you know, somehow afford living. Because right now, if I don't get any source of income, I'm not going to be able to live here. I'm probably going to have to go back to Tennessee, live with my parents, and somehow work that out. So I'm hoping to really stay here, make a living. And as I earn money that way, I want to really become involved in kind of be a regular volunteer to some organization that I really, really like. That's what I always wanted to be, kind of a nonprofit worker that doesn't get paid. And getting a dog walker position allows me to do that. It allows me to help people without feeling like I'm making money off of their misery, which is what social workers get accused of. I want to lead that kind of a lifestyle for a while. You know, I want to But I get this dog walking position. They always, no, and this isn't the first dog walking interview that I've done. The one before that I also interviewed for Pup Pals before the Eva's PlayPups. And they all ask 6 months commitment minimum. And definitely I could do that. I'm totally willing to stay at this dog walking position for year, 2 years, 3 years, whatever, if I'm able to make a living off of it and just be able to keep on my feet and pay my bills and also have time to kind of act according to my beliefs in helping others, providing nonprofits, volunteering, and just staying on my feet. Totally, I am totally willing to go down that route, but right now I just need to be needed. That's the thing. I am. It's getting hired is a pretty rough process, I have to say. I really like taking social work to everywhere I go. You know, the values of meeting people and learning their stories is, I can't say it's like a hobby of mine or anything, but it's just something I love about being alive. You know, meeting other people, learning their stories, and just communicating with them. And even though being a security guard sounds like the least likely place to encounter that, I really, really enjoyed learning the stories of these security guards, my ex-coworkers, you know, really coming to encounter so many lives of, you know, as a tutor, as a security guard, I really come to really kind of witness how people live, and most of it's not pretty. It's like the way Americans live is pretty disheartening sometimes, but in a lot of ways it's also inspiring because it shows the resilience of people. It shows how strong they are to really overcome the obstacles they could take across. And now I'm just rambling about stuff like this, but you know, but that was quite an experience. And if this dog walking thing doesn't work out, if I don't get hired, I think I'm gonna try to apply to be a canvasser again, and probably in a different company. Just, you know, the reason I didn't apply again to another canvassing company after that was because it was winter and like, oh my God, like suffering through that cold for 8 hours in a single spot. We're not moving, we're staying rooted to the ground. It was freezing cold. I mean, I'm willing to endure the cold and all that, and dog walking position certainly would require me to walk, you know, all day in freezing cold weathers too. So the summer I'm not too worried about. It's the winter. I really am not good at surviving the winter, but that I'm prepared for. But in any case, that was that, and also because I just didn't like how unstable the position was, because there's quota to fill in canvassing. There's quota to fill every day, every week, pretty much. If you don't raise a certain amount of money in a given week, you're given like a warning. If you're official staff, if you're not established enough, you might get fired. But yeah, you're given like, okay, well, this week was horrible, next week do better. If you don't do better, then you're fired. So there's that pressure of raising a certain amount of money every week. And I was thinking about that made me like back away from applying again. But it is a really fun job that I really enjoy doing. So if this dog walking thing doesn't work out, definitely gonna apply again to canvassing. Another reason that really invites me to canvassing is because I think canvassing companies hire super quick because, you know, because they fire people super quick, they gotta hire people super quick. So when I applied to grassroots campaigns, I was actually, I interviewed the very next day that I called. I got interviewed. And the very next day I started on my observance day. So in 2 days, I had my shot of being hired. You know, just 2 days. I mean, normal hiring process takes so much longer. Even this dog walking position, I emailed, you know, Eva's PlayPups like 3 weeks ago, right? And I get an email response back like 5 days later. And then I email her back. And I get a response like 5 days later. And then we do an interview. And then I still have to wait. I mean, that's a pretty fast process, considering the other jobs like nonprofit organizations and businesses and stuff. But canvassing? Freaking A. I'm getting hired in 2 days? That's ridiculous. So I really can't afford to wait anymore. So if this doesn't work out, I'm definitely applying to be a canvasser. I really do hope this works out, though. I really am liking the prospect of dog walking in. Just walking around the city like this is pretty fun.